So I'm speaking with Jeremy Zuckerman, who, along with Benjamin Wynn, I think are changing the way a dramatic animated series is scored. Jeremy is behind the hit shows Avatar, The Last Airbender, The Legend of Korra, and Kung Fu Panda, Legends of Awesomeness. His music stands apart as emotionally fueled and thematically sound, and the structure of his scores are something you'd never expect for these types of animated shows. Thanks so much for chatting today.
Oh, thank you. My pleasure, and thanks for the kind intro.
So this is the first time we're talking. I would love to know what music means to you from a personal view, and what led you to composing?
Well, I really got serious about music at a pretty young age, and it's something I've always sort of, it's always sort of been a calling, I guess, for me. There was never really, like, there was never much of a question of doing something else, for better or for worse. You know, at times I've wished that I was good at something else besides music, just to have a, you know, a break from it. But for some reason, like, it just seems like that came easy to me. And at a pretty young age, I decided that I was going to pursue it. I remember being in a band with a good friend. It started out just he on drums and me playing guitar, and we'd play really loud and blow our ears out. And I remember being 13 and sitting down late at night, hanging out with him, and we were just talking about what we were going to do for our lives at that age. And he was saying he wanted to pursue music, and I remember not even sort of considering that an option. Like, I wanted to do it, but I thought that was way just not realistic. Like, people just can't make a living doing that.
Right.
And then he kind of encouraged me and was like, of course you can, you know. So I sort of decided at that moment, I was like, okay, I'm going to do music then. I was at 13. So there was never, like, I was lucky in the sense I never had to go through that period. And most people have to go through where they're not sure what they want to do with their lives and what their careers are. And I always sort of had this goal. I wasn't sure exactly how I was going to work in the music field. Like, I think I thought I was going to be a guitarist, in a band or something, in a metal band or something. But so actually getting into composing was definitely something I didn't expect. And it just kind of happened. Like, I was there at the right place at the right time. And I met, you know, Ben at CalArts. And Ben was close friends with Brian Kanisko, the co-creator of Avatar.
Oh, okay.
And yeah, so Brian and Mike had just started creating Avatars. You know, they were just sort of putting it together in their brains and making the Bible. And actually, I think at that point they had sold it to Nickelodeon. And they asked if Ben and I would come in and do music and sound design for it. And before that, I had done like a bunch of commercials. I'd been working with a smaller company, and we did a ton of commercials. That was, you know, it was a really good way for me to get a variety of musical skills, you know, happening. And so I was ready in that sense, but I also had never done anything long form.
Right.
So it definitely was a leap for me. And Brian was just like, make sure, you know, he's like, make sure you understand what you're saying yes to, because this isn't going to just be like, you know, six months and that's it. Like, this is going to be a path that you'll be on for a long time.
Were you nervous about it?
I don't know. I think I was too young and naive to be nervous. Maybe I was a little bit, you know, working with Ben. Like, Ben has a way of not getting too stressed out about things. Like, mm-hmm. I'm the one who stresses. So I think the fact that it was two of us in the trenches helped. I mean, we divided tasks. Like, he wound up doing sound design and I wound up doing music, but we were often like in the same room working together, you know, for that first season, we were in the same room working together. And even though he was doing sound design, like, with headphones, and I'd be, you know, my system with the volume down way low doing the music and asking each other to stop when we needed to record something. But the fact that there was the two of us, I think, helped to like mitigate the stress, and also because Brian was a good friend at that point, he became a good friend. And so it didn't feel like the stakes didn't feel as high as I think they were.
Mm-hmm.
We didn't realize that we probably could have been fired if it didn't work out, you know, by Nick or something.
And it's become this, you know, something of a worldwide phenomenon. And I think its popularity is a testament to the show's writers and as well as the music. How do you think the series was unique versus all the other, there's a sea of animated series out there, but this one really stands out. What did you want to do with the music that would make it stand out and not just be kind of part of the mainstream?
Well, for Avatar, I think a lot of it was just the fact that I really didn't have the experience or didn't know that world. And I think Brian wanted that, you know, I think that was a conscious choice where he wanted someone who was coming from a different area. Like I had been studying really esoteric stuff at CalArts, and you know, my world was not at all, you know, film scoring or you know, let alone animation scoring.
Right.
So I brought in like some other ideas, some computer music ideas, even though it's not a computer music score at all.
Yeah, not at all. It's very thematic and very kind of lush and big.
Right. But some of my sort of my compositional ideas were coming from that world and my approaches to sound and stuff like that. So it informed it in a way that I think made it a bit different. And a lot of it was just not just ignorance, you know, like not knowing how a score is supposed to function all the time and sort of figuring it out and probably doing things that some people would say was wrong. And maybe I would say is wrong now too. You know, but at the time, you know, I was just figuring it out.
So now Legend of Korra is, I mean, just as big of a success as it's a spinoff, you know, from Avatar. And I love your score for book one. The release is just simply fantastic. And in what ways did the music evolve, I guess, for Legend of Korra? Did you keep anything you established in Avatar, or did you kind of just hit the refresh button and start from scratch?
Originally, I wanted to really start from scratch because I felt, it's been a long time since Avatar, and I've learned a lot since then, and I've grown a lot, you know, creatively, artistically, and I didn't want to sort of go back to that world. And one of the main things for me was working with live musicians this time around, which is a much different way of doing things because you spend more time composing and less time, I guess, in the production side of things, which is, you know, making things sound good.
Right.
Sort of covering up the fact that it's a computer and trying to make it sound realistic, whereas, you know, so when you're working that way, there's certain things you just can't write because it doesn't sound good using a MIDI library.
Absolutely. Yeah.
So, you know, so it really can influence your writing. It does influence your writing, and that's one of like my biggest problems with MIDI, is that I don't want anything influencing, you know, my composition except my own limitations. You know. So I went and chose to get a small, like string sextet together, and this Chinese instrumentalist Hong Wang, who plays a ton of different instruments, and I wanted it to be sort of smaller in that sense and more intimate, more human, where you could hear like breathing in the recording, you know.
Right. Yeah.
You can hear just like little, you know, like it's not always perfectly in tune. I mean, these are amazing musicians, so, but it's not a computer, so there's going to be, and we don't have an insane budget, and when there's a smaller ensemble, you hear all the, you know, the little details much more. You hear little, you know, inconsistencies or little sort of flaws that really glare out, where as opposed to if you have, you know, a 60-piece string orchestra, you know, you won't hear those little pitch discrepancies and things like that.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so that was one thing. And I think, yeah, just the tone is much different for Korra. It's more mature.
Yeah, absolutely.
And it can get a bit darker, although Avatar definitely had its dark moments.
When I was listening to the score, I was like, this is, you know, like heavy drama going on. It was a very emotionally engaging score. And
that's always been my thing, is I try not to, I mean, obviously you have to do what's best for the project. That's first and foremost. But also at the same time, I try not to like dumb down, for lack of a phrase. You know what I mean? I don't go in there thinking I'm writing for kids or animation, because kids feel stuff very deeply. And they understand it, you know. You don't have to dumb it down for them at all.
Yeah, I think one of my favorite directors is Don Bluth, and I think his films are, I mean, I think he said that too. It's just like, you know, kids are more, I think they can handle that. So, I mean, his films are what I remember growing up, you know, Land Before Time and Secret of Nim, those stuff that's...
Yeah, that was heavy stuff.
Yeah, it's definitely. Watching it now,
that's why we loved it.
Yeah. You
know? Yeah.
So, I mean, you have a lot of wonderful instruments and sounds and textures in the music. Did you experiment with different things to find the sound that you wanted before you kind of settled on it? Or do you kind of keep all that in your head and go, okay, this will be perfect. Let's use that.
That's a good question. Well, some of it is, there's some degree of experimentation. There's not a lot of time for that, unfortunately.
Right.
So some of it is things that I've done in the past, like on other projects. Like there was I also occasionally use, how do I describe this without sounding too nerdy? There's a computer music element in there, but the thing about Korra and Avatar is that when you use computer music elements, you don't want them to sound techie.
Right.
You know,
right.
It still has to sound very natural and organic and very physical and real. So I use a software called Super Collider, which is like super nerdy audio software that you learn. You know, like I got exposed to it at CalArts doing my master's program, and it's usually used, you know, in very academic music.
Mm-hmm.
And it's all text. There's no graphics or anything, and it's basically a programming language, but it's for audio. So you can do pretty much anything with it. And so I'll like for Aman, you know, I don't know, if, you know, Aman has these pitch percussion gamelan like textures
mm-hmm.
often underneath the music, and that is actually generated by a block of code that has these sort of various parameters that you can put in there, like pitches and rhythms and tempo and things like that. But it's within that, it's randomizing, sort of randomly choosing different pitches, different rhythms and things like that. And it's all the samples being input into the code are different pitch percussion instruments. And I keep kind of coming back to that patch because it's a really powerful patch and can do a lot of things. Like you can play with the pitch, it can be out of tune more or less, and you can mm-hmm. do that over time, and it can be out of time more or less, to the point where it's just a texture that has no rhythm at all, or very, you know, syncopated, or very, it could be quarter notes, you know, whatever. It's a really powerful thing, and you can input different samples into it. So I keep coming back to it and finding new ways to use it as a, just an underlying element, you know, not a really in-your-face element, but something that adds a little special sauce, you know?
Yeah.
And then as far as like all the Chinese instruments, before Korra, we started Kung Fu Panda before we started Korra. So
okay.
We actually started working with Hong on that project, and he taught me a lot of stuff. He'd just bring a ton of instruments. And so over time I started to get comfortable with the timbres and the ranges and the performative aspects of those instruments. And you know, there's just so lyrical, and a lot of that is his performance, of course.
Right, it becomes the human behind the instrument performing
right.
it.
Right.
And I've talked to composers, you know, who work on broadcast television and stuff like that. So, what's the production schedule like for shows like Avatar, Legend of Korra? How long does each episode take? At what point in production does music come into play? Do you wait for the finished episodes? Do you read the scripts, watch animatics? Like, well, how do you kind of get into the story?
I don't know exactly how long the entire production is at before we get it. I know mm-hmm. it's a long time, though. Like, it takes a very long time to animate it. And I know then, I think they do the voice recording first.
Right, yeah.
You know, and then they animate it. That process takes a while before we get it. Like, I know that they've started recording. I'm not sure exactly. Don't quote me on this. Well, I guess you're going to quote me on this. But I think they've started recording book 3, possibly 4. Like, I know they're writing that stuff right now.
Uh-huh.
So pretty far ahead. And it takes a while before it gets to us. Once we get it, we have 2 weeks from the time we do what's called a spotting session.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And the spotting session is, you know, when we get together with Brian and Mike and talk about the audio needs, sound design, music, and Foley, and go just sort of meticulously through the episode, taking notes and talking about things. But the thing is, so we don't really have 2 weeks to work on it. You know, I get it, but I'm still finalizing doing revisions from the previous episode. I still have to record the strings and Hong for that episode, edit and mix them, prep it for delivery, you know, and then send it off to the dub.
Yeah.
To be dubbed. And then, so really I probably have about 4 or 5 days for each episode.
Wow.
Right, music. Yeah, and it never gets easier either. It never gets faster. It's always the same sort of limping to the finish line.
And you think that with animation, since it's such a long process, that you would have more time, but it's just as hectic as a live-action show.
I know, it's nuts. It's crazy. And you don't really have the budget to have a team, you know, like orchestrators and, you know, mix editor, you know, music editor and all that other. Some people have that stuff, but...
There's always dreaming and wishing.
Yeah. I mean, I choose to use the budget for the live musicians more.
Right, which I think matters and is very important. So how much music does one episode of Korra usually need?
It can range. On the least music we've had, I think, was 12 minutes. Usually it's around 15, 16 minutes. Mm-hmm. And the most it's been 22, which is pretty much wall-to-wall.
Yeah, that's a full episode.
Yeah.
Oh, that's still a lot of music for 4 or 5 days.
Yeah, yeah. And the music, you know, Korra's, it's hard writing for Korra because it's so varied. Like, the situations change so much. And
right, yeah.
So emotional. You know, it's very dramatic. And it just takes a lot of energy.
I can imagine.
Yeah.
And you also do Kung Fu Panda, Legends of Awesomeness, which is the television show of the films. I mean, the films have amazing scores by Hans Zimmer and John Powell.
Yeah, it's a great score.
Did you take them into consideration when you jumped on this project? Or
Do
composers like to just be like, I don't care what they did, and try to do your own thing?
I guess it depends on the composer, but this was such an established, it was so established already that I wanted to, you know, sort of pay respect and go check out the scores and analyze them a bit. And I spent some time actually like analyzing them and, you know, charting some cues down and checking out what they were doing. And they were doing some really interesting stuff, some really cool stuff harmonically that did inform my score a bit I think that they're definitely pretty different.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I've watched a couple episodes of Kung Fu Panda and it's really well done. It's the animation and even the voice acting is almost spot on. It's different actors, but it's just like...
Wiener, the guy who does Poe, does a great job.
Yeah. And
he's almost more Jack Black than Jack Black.
Yeah. I was like, wow, they got Jack Black for this. Like, nope, they didn't. But you did want to create your own specific sound for the show?
I did. But I also knew that I wasn't creating something from the ground up the way I did with Avatar and with Korra.
Right.
So it was definitely a different approach, and it felt different, you know, to work that way. In some ways, it's less stressful, you know, because I almost feel like there's less responsibility in some strange way. I mean, I'm definitely not copying or quoting the music.
Not at all.
But it informs it in some way where it's, you know, you're not creating something from the ground up exactly.
Right.
You know, there's a starting point, and that was pretty helpful.
I always find it interesting to talk because, like, a lot of composers do video games that are kind of based off the big, you know, blockbuster counterpart, and in a lot of cases, it's funny just how rights work because they can't use the themes from the film or whatever, but they just also you don't want to kind of create your own groundwork and everything.
Right, yeah, you can't really use it. And then if you do, you wind up in like cue sheet situations where you have to give credit. And
yeah.
I mean, possibly, maybe I could have if I really wanted to because...
Because Nickelodeon is Paramount, right?
Right. But then I would have had to share royalties, so screw that.
Yeah, Hans and John, they don't need royalties.
Yeah, they're okay. I think they're all right.
Well, to wrap up, I always like to ask composers, if you could score any film ever made, with no disrespect to the original composer or the score itself, what film would you choose?
Oh, wow. Okay, let me think about this. How about The Last Airbender? No, I think that would have to be an entire rewrite. You know? No offense. I would have loved to have seen what Brian and Mike would have done with the live action thing.
No, it was it was a mess.
Yeah, but you know the score actually was really beautiful.
Oh yeah, James Newton Howard did a fan. I think everyone I talked to was like, yeah, the score was great, but the script was a mess.
The score I remember one moment really sticking out, the waterbender, the water tribe theme. It just really felt like water flowing with the orchestra, with the strings. He did a really nice job with that. He had this sort of this repeating gesture that really stuck out to me. I was like, that's a really beautiful, smart way of portraying that.
Was it interesting to see someone else take on subject matter that you kind of established?
Yeah, it was. I mean, it was a little hard, you know, but it was interesting. But it felt so different than the TV show that it didn't hurt as much as it might be. Maybe it would have, you know, like my baby's gone off to college,
got beat up by the world.
I could have sworn there were a couple moments where I felt like it was slightly informed by the TV show, but I really don't know if that's true or not, because it's possible that it's me imagining it. I would love to ask James someday, or have, you know, be like, did you watch it? Like, you know, because I'm just so curious. I remember, like, the end credits. I felt like he quoted the main theme really subtly.
Mm-hmm.
But again, it could be coincidence, because when you're dealing with tonal music, you know,
right.
There's only so many melodies and harmonies that, you know, chord progressions that will sound pleasing to people, you know, and they've all been done. So, you know, unless you really want to get out there, it's hard to really, you know, you're gonna always find connections to.
I know a lot of people are like, oh, they copy that. It's like, well, it's a lot of music being composed by a lot of people.
Exactly. People have found it. Hey, this sounds just like blah, blah, blah. I'm like, I have no idea what you're talking about. Like, I've never heard that. They're like, that's the exact same thing, you know?
Yeah.
So when you write a lot of music, you know, you're going to write people are going to write the same melodies. And
mm-hmm.
It's going to happen.
So is Last Airbender your decision for the.
Oh, man, I don't know. God, that's hard. Let me.
Like, just like a playground you'd love to, like, play in, just like try it out. Like a favorite movie of yours, a favorite score of yours that you would have.
You know, it was maybe something like Solaris.
Oh, that's a good one.
I love the score to Solaris. So I don't. That'd be
the original or the Cliff Martinez. You know,
actually, I'm ashamed to say I haven't seen the original.
Okay.
So I should track that down. But the remake, you know, Cliff Martinez's score to that was fantastic, and the vibe, mm-hmm. you know. This sort of, it's like you're just sort of sleepwalking through the movie. I feel like that could be really fun to explore. It's just, it just would be such a different approach to the animation that I do, which is so scored and so dynamic and
and
just changing constantly. You know what I mean? It would be nice to be able to sit with an idea for 10 minutes. You know.
Yeah, Cliff's music is great. His and Only God Forgives didn't really get that much exposure, but his score for that was quite good.
I haven't seen that yet. You know, it's terrible. I really don't get out to see movies much.
I hear from composers, yeah.
Yeah, I'm just working, and then when I'm not working, I'm with, you know, I have two young kids, so I'm just, it's hard to make it happen. But I did just see Wolf's Children. I mean, have you heard of that?
No, I haven't. I think I have. I think I've heard of it, but
I can't remember the director's name right now, which is really shameful because he's like a huge Japanese director. It's animation, and it's really beautiful. It's just it's a story of this single mother who raises these two children who are like part wolf.
Hmm.
They're like werewolves sort of, and it's just really beautiful. You know, it's just a beautiful movie.
There's some great animated films, like mature animated films too, that are being made, and, you know, from Miyazaki and everybody. It's just like great stuff out there.
Yeah, it was a Funimation production, and it was just really beautiful.
Well, I think I'm out of questions for you, but thanks so much for the time and everything. It was a real blast to chat, Jeremy. It was great.
Yeah, great to talk to you too.